Getting started with plasTeX, which is something I use every day. And I work for SAS Institute, which is an analytical software company that does business intelligence. And the documents I work with are kind of highly mathematically dense, so plasTeX has got a job to do. So we'll talk about what is it in the first place and in what conditions you might find it useful. How it works, we won't go into much detail about how it works because probably you don't care, but you need to know a little bit about the underlying mechanism to take advantage of it. Basically, there's an interface and there's two steps, the parsing and the rendering. So those are the two big parts of plasTeX. The goal with parsing is to generate a document object model or DOM, which is just a kind of a tree structure of data. And you can extend that with Python classes. And the next step, which is the rendering, the goal is to get our output, and that's extensible with templates. We'll take a look at a demo so you can see it in action. The normal sample 2e.tech that comes with the tech distribution, just to have something to start with. And then we'll take a look at a couple of papers I downloaded from archive.org. And finally, we'll have a summary. So plasTeX is it converts LaTeX sources to HTML, XML, and other markup languages. It's released as open source under the MIT license, which is a very permissive license. And it's written in pure Python by Kevin Smith, who is also an employee at SAS. My contribution to this project is haranguing Kevin at lunch for about 2 years to get him to write this. I use it as part of a publishing workflow to create our statistical documentation at SAS. Just to give you a brief overview about where I'm coming from, at SAS, I have a system that I call SAS LaTeX. And we take a LaTeX markup, math fonts, we use MathTime Pro 2, and a custom tag set I wrote just to facilitate things, shortcuts for our writers. Because the people that I work with, it's not technical writers in conjunction with the developer as a subject matter expert. That happens at SAS, but the people I work with, part of their job is writing. So they're developers of the software and they write. So they are using this custom tag set as to facilitate their writing, but they're also developing the software at the same time. Okay, so that gets into SAS LaTeX system, and we make sure that it's heavy with output and with SAS programming code, so we have a system in place to make sure that the code that the reader sees is the code that generated the output. And then that tech file gets parsed by PDF LaTeX or compiled by PDF LaTeX to PDF. And that's very important for our developers because they are active in the statistical and mathematical community and they want to make sure their papers look good because our audience is kind of expecting that too. And then we send the also through plasTeX to get HTML and XML. And we can also send it through the parser to get the sample library code for customers so they can see the actual code that got the outputs. So we have a customized tag set. Everything's written in Python. All this other stuff except LaTeX. And so the whole point is to get high quality PDFs, and we give those out as books and as chapters. One of the books we produce is the SAS Stat User's Guide. It's a pretty good trip test because it's 8,000 pages and we produce it all as one document and we create it as chapters. But lots of hyperlinks, lots of output, a whole lot of math, and a lot of code. And each night we build the system and we get about 20,000 pages per nightly build. Okay, so back to plasTeX. So what it is good at is these conversions, and one of the main things that I wanted to point out is pluggable math engines, it uses DVIPing by default. And I know nobody likes having math inside their HTML to be images, and I understand that, but this is the real world, and I haven't seen anything that renders MathML yet in a high quality way. Or I think SVG will, but I think we're going to have a problem with font embedding there to get the right agreements to work. So we're using DVIPing. Once things change, this is a pluggable thing. It's not built into plasTeX. We just call DVIPing. So we could call something else to create JSMath or MathML or SVG later on so we can adapt as technology comes along. It has a translation terms for most European languages. If you need more for other languages, it's very easy. It's just a XML file that looks for the generated text and the key. And support for multiple encodings, which is important for us because everything comes in as Latin 1, but it goes out, it might be in Windows 1252 or UTF-8 is usually what we do, but sometimes we have a restriction. So when does it make sense to use plasTeX? If you've got something that works on your project, there's no reason to change. But if you're starting a new project, it's an easy package to load. It's an easy package to use. And if you're dealing with projects too complex for other tools, for me, I needed something that was simple to understand, and the Python classes are pretty simple. So when somebody comes to me and says, the documentation is broken, you've got a nested paragraph coming out of this environment. If it was LaTeX HTML, at least as it was 12 years ago when I started, that would have just made me want to cry. But now with this, I can just look and see, okay, it's coming from this class, here's the template, what's the problem? And obviously implementing a production publishing workflow. There's a lot of things that has to happen there, and this is a good way to support that. So the way we interface with plasTeX is through the command line. There's no GUI, but it's got a lot of switches that you can use, and some of the most important ones are specify themes and navigational elements, which if we're going to Java help with one flavor of HTML, then we need some kind of navigation that's different than you might use in HTML help. So depending on the application that we're trying to support, we'll have a different theme and different navigational elements. We specify the input and output encoding. Set counters, like if we want to, the SAS Stat User's Guide would be pretty hard to build into a document object model all at once. So I'll build those chapter by chapter, so I can set the chapter counter with each build. And you can dynamically set the table of contents step, so part of your document you want only the first two headings, and your details maybe you want the first three. You can set that. Set the section numbering depth, and specify the image generation engine, which is another way of saying specify how to handle math. Schematic, there's a lot of stuff on here, but let me see if I can figure this out. Yeah. Oh, you hold it down. Okay. So the two big boxes, here's the LaTeX sources, and first it does the parsing, and the next it does the rendering. So in the parsing part, we tokenize and then parse, and then it just returns the document object model after it's parsed all that stuff, put it into the dictionary of data, and then it comes back to the renderer, and then these are just sets of templates for different output formats. So we can render to plain text, docbook, or HTML. There's also a man page render, but I've never had a use to use that. So, and then we can get our different kinds of output. So once you pass the LaTeX source in, it goes in two steps. Parse it into data, and then render it to output. Okay, the parser has, when it gets your document in, it's got to recognize everything it sees, so it knows how to put that data into a structured structure. And so it understands most of the built-in LaTeX and tech commands. You can't pass it the memoir class and expect it to expand everything the right way. You can pass it simple things and just have regular LaTeX macro, new macros, new commands, new environments, and it'll figure it out. But if it gets very complex, cat code changes, it might choke on it. So what Kevin did was create Python classes to support these packages, so those come with the plasTeX distribution. But I can tell you, sometimes these don't have any kind of corollary in HTML or XML. Like A4 wide, we don't really have any use for that in DocBook or HTML. So that's probably an empty class inside the plasTeX distribution. It's just so plasTeX won't choke when it sees use A4 wide package. It knows, okay, I know what to do with that, or at least I think I do. And then it can continue parsing. So some of these things are just meant so it can ignore it, although there's a lot of stuff in the AMS math and graphics. There's just a different level of logic in each one of these packages. So just because it's in this list, it might not mean it does exactly what you think. But what we're trying to do is to make it where it will parse a document and at least get through it so you can start working from there if you need to. Boris?
How difficult is to write a Python class for a new package?
It's a good question, and I'm going to address that in just a minute, because if it wasn't easy, I wouldn't have done it. I need something simple. So let's take an example, and we'll just take a look at the framebox command. This is already defined in plasTeX, but it's just an example we can look at. We're going to see a backslash, the word framebox. We can take two optional arguments, and then we're going to have some text. So plasTeX parses that document, and this is the plasTeX code to create that class. That's the actual code, class framebox. So now we're going to have a framebox element. It's subclassing or inheriting from textbox command, which is something Kevin wrote. This kind of a lower level thing. And this is exactly the way I work. Is if I have a new command or a new environment, I look to see what Kevin already has there that's close to it, and then just subclass from it. And often that's all I have to do. I've got a whole list of class with some name, and it just says pass under each one because it knows enough already to parse it. Another great thing about this interface is we've got args equal and then the signature of the command, because all you have to do is put brackets around it and knows it's going to be optional. We're going to name that with. We're going to name the second optional argument pause, and the next part is going to be the self content. So once we have this, we know the data we're actually looking for when we have parsed that that tag. So it saves the resulting name tokens in the document data structure, and we've already got those parts named. So there's the parsing. Okay, that was one command. It would do the same thing for every command in the document. Next, we're going to render it, and it's built on templating, which is current methodology in web framework. So that really means we're going to take that document object, that data, and apply templates for every object in there and automatically generate our document. It's extremely fast. So for example, here's a, say we were coming across this in our LaTeX source, frame box, and we want 15 EMs of width. And note that this is important is our text. And so it comes out like that in Beamer, or it comes out like that in PDF. The data created by the parser, it needs to find a template that has the same name. So we've got name, frame box, we've got a document element named frame box. And it's going to apply the data it has to this template. Well, I've just hard-coded a class equals fbox on this, so that doesn't have anything to do with dynamics. It's just any frame box I have is going to have that class, because I'll deal with it later in CSS. Then this is a templating language. It came from IBM. It's called TAL. That's, I don't know what that stands for, but probably templating something language. And attributes, we're going to set an attribute. The attribute is called style. Its value is going to be a string, and its width. We're going to get that width from that argument that we got in the data structure. And the content that goes inside this span tag is going to be whatever content was in the frame box. So the output, can you see that at the bottom? It span class equals fbox, so it just took my verbatim boilerplate there. Style equals width, colon 15, you know, that, I wrote this, it didn't generate because it would have had quotes around it like it should. And then note that this is important is the text. So we went from the LaTeX source through the template and then got our output. So we just continue to do that all the way through the document. So plasTeX can render the following formats: plain text, which can be useful if you need to de-tech a file, HTML, well-formed XML is really easy because the internal representation of a document object within plasTeX is well-formed XML. It doesn't follow any particular DTD, but it is well-formed. If you're careful, you can output DocBook 4.5, and I'm working on 5.0 right now. That's why it's in italics. But you can't just throw anything at plasTeX and expect to get valid DocBook. You'll get valid XML, well-formed XML. But if you put a piece of math inside an index term, it just isn't going to be valid in DocBook, and there's nothing we can do about that. But if you're careful about what you do, especially avoid nesting tags, I've found that's been generally the hardest thing, you can output DocBook 4.5. And once you're in that, you can go to a lot of different things and be able to interchange with other publishers too. S5 is a simple standard-based slideshow system which is in HTML. If you have it in Beamer, I don't know why you'd want it in HTML, but Kevin wrote the render, and so I'm telling you about it. BrailleTeX, it's in italics because it's not really part of plasTeX. It's something someone wrote, I think in the UK, but it is an open source LaTeX to Braille translator that is designed to handle math. It's on sourceforge.net. And I have EPUBs in italic because I have that working at SAS, but I haven't put it up at SourceForge to make it publicly available because it's a lot harder to do it for the general case than it is for the documents I know I'm dealing with. But that'll be there soon. Okay, let's take a look at a demo. Once again, we'll take a look at sample2e.tech and a couple of papers from archive.org, which if you don't know, it's an open, what do we say, open access to over 500,000 eprints in physics, math, computer science, the hard sciences. Oh, let's see. That'll be fine. I'll just come back. Okay, just so you know what I'm going to do, and so I'll know what I'm supposed to do, I've got some little notes over here, examples. So we'll take a look at sample 2e. Now, in this directory, I don't have anything, but I'm going to say plasTeX sample2e.tech, because underneath plasTeX is using KPSE which to find your files. So if you, it'll find this, but if you specify a style file, it knows where to go get it. If we haven't defined Python equivalents, it will go find it in the tech file and try to expand it. So it's using that under the covers. And so we just hit return, and I'll show you a couple of things. Okay, so you see it, I'll just scroll up to this in just a second because a lot's going to happen right here. Before we take a look at the output, I just want to show you what happened on the screen. Is the very first thing is it loaded article.py. or PYC is the compiled version, and that is the article class, and that's what sample2e loaded, and apparently it didn't load anything else, no other packages, or we would see it there. So that came from the Python distribution. It's going to output its files to a subdirectory, the same name, the job name, and then it reads its templates from these locations, and if we set an environment variable, we can make it look at our own copies, and we'll override the distributions. And so it's reading these from the XHTML template library because that's the default renderer. Tells us what it's going to use for an integer, and then it's creating some HTML. It did not know what to do with the at symbol, which I think is backslash at for the spacing. And so Kevin didn't do that. It's an easy thing we could add. And images.tech it created. And then you're all familiar with that log screen where we're just doing LaTeX to get the DVI. And okay, so we've got images log, and then DVI ping created 5 images. Okay, and they're all named the way they should be, so let's just take a look. Okay, so there's the example document. The default theme is this green. Kevin likes green. That's the default. So we get these bars and we get navigational elements that are all in there, and there's metadata at the top of this HTML file inside. Table of contents, so we'll just take a quick look at this. What you would expect, this is the LaTeX sample file, and we get some italics, we get the quotes, we have a footnote, and there's the footnote here at the bottom that that got there. And let's see.
How yeah. Let the logo down.
Mm-hmm. At the bottom?
Yeah, the logo. LaTeX interprets.
Oh, yeah.
Sub and sub?
Yeah, that's what it is. But that would be, yeah.
Apollo can that would give you about 1,000 lines of code to implement those logos.
Okay. Well, that could be done, or we could override it with whatever template we wanted to. And the way Kevin did it was, if you see slash LaTeX, then it's going to put in the subs and supers. So I'll blame that on him. But at the top, you can see we're getting breadcrumbs plus the back or previous, next, and up. So that's just the standard stuff that you get. And then displayed text, we have unordered list and ordered list. You know, this kind of things you would expect. There's a little bit of math, and that's it. And if you click on content, that would take you back, in our case, to the first page.
So the displayed map,
yours
those are PNG images?
They're pings, yeah.
Yours was rendered really wet.
Which one?
Yours.
Oh, yeah, verses are horrible. But what do you do with verse and HTML? You'd have to do a lot. You could do it, but it would take a lot of work.
Yeah.
Okay, let's... Now I'm just going to copy this over here so I don't make a mistake. What I'm doing is I'm going to render, but this time instead of using the default render of XHTML, render it to text. I don't want it wants to split files up by section, and that's why we had those several HTML files. There's no reason to do that for a text file. And so I'm setting the split level to be 0. And that's all the magic there is on the command line. And it's going to do the same thing. It loads. It has to do the same thing every time it parses. That's always identical. What happens at the end that's different is how it renders. So let's just look at index.txt. Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's trying to do as good as it can. It's still got things numbered. Blank lines are where they should be. The characters are right, the quotes are right. The math it left like it was. So it just, whatever was in the math, it left it there, which I think that's probably the best decision you could make. And then the unordered list or asterisks and the numbered list, ordered list is the numbers, obviously. And the math is there again, and the footnote is there at the end. Okay, and one last thing with this little simple file. We'll just use a docbook render. And what else do? There are three themes for docbook, and one is book, one is chapter, and one is article. This is an article, and if you don't use the right theme, you'll get invalid docbook.
Martin?
Yeah, I just noticed the poetry.
Oh, in the text. Good point. Okay, that's something that needs to be taken care of.
Probably not a lot of verse environments in the SAS.
Yeah, well, we try to keep them to a minimum.
Maybe once in a while someone slips a limerick in.
Yeah, right.
Okay, let's just take a quick look at that. XML Mind is this version is a free XML reader, and it knows DocBook when it sees it. You can see up here it thinks, okay, this is DocBook, stuff that I could do with it, I guess. And it's valid. There's a little mark here that says, yeah, it's okay. Of course, it's not very complicated, but it is valid. And let's see, there's something I wanted to show you, because I think it's kind of a neat idea that came from DB LaTeX, which is a way to go from DocBook back to LaTeX. So if you were to, you could take this document and produce LaTeX back again from it. I'm just going to switch the view from their attempt at showing rendering DocBook to something you can read to no style sheet. Okay, so the sentence was, it's good at typesetting mathematical formulas like, and we get an inline equation with an inline media object that is composed of two parts, an image object and a text object. The image object is obviously that ping we just created. The text object is the math, so we haven't lost the math. And if we process this with DB LaTeX, it'll find that tech source in the text object and reproduce the math in whatever format it's needed. So I think that's about all there is to say about that. And the same thing for displayed math. Okay. Well, let's see. Oh yeah, the output directory that we've been filing these things to is right here. And what if you're creating HTML, you see these CHMs? Everybody know what a CHM file is? It's the Windows compiled help. And so you've got the files you need to create Windows compiled help along with the HTML. So you just feed these files into HTML Help Workshop, which is a free download from Microsoft, and you've got a Windows compiled help version of your document. And the same thing for Eclipse, if you're familiar with Eclipse Help or Java Help version 1 or 2. Kevin's created the auxiliary files you need just to feed that and then get that help in a browser, in a real application. And, the main reason I changed this directory is this one right here. I made plasTeX dump its internal representation. So I just wanted to show you what that looks like. Sample2e.xml, this is the way it looks to plasTeX. So it's another well-formed XML file. It's got a namespace, plasTeX, and you can see make title, everything, every element has an ID. So we've got paragraphs, and so everything is named, and let's see if there's anything interesting here to say. The title, it has a modifier, but the modifier is blank, so we could have had title star, I guess. And so everything in there looks somewhat like that. Everything is named, everything has an ID, so we can, when we're rendering this with a real template, it's not doing anything with this, I'm just showing you this to show you what it kind of looks like inside. But everything is named and everything has an ID, so we can get to each document on it. Okay, I wanted to show you a couple other things. This is a file that came from archive.org, and let's just take a look at what that does. This is a file from the wild. It's not sample2e.txt, so there's a little bit more involved. One thing I found on archive is that a lot of the papers there use RevTeX, a class that I didn't know about, and plasTeX doesn't support. It looks like it would be easy to make it support it, but that's one reason I was having failures on a lot of papers from RevTeX. This particular one, I guess, used article and AMS math. So it's creating the math there. That'll take a second. And then we'll see what it looks like. But to be able to add a package or add a class, it's as simple as writing the Python statements, which are about as simple as what I was showing you before. You just subclass off something else and write a renderer. And that's it. Then you'll be able to parse that new class.
As simple or as complex as writing the new Python statements.
Well, if I can do it, it's not that hard. Okay, so now we've got a bigger paper, still an article. We've got our abstract and the table of contents. And there's no reason to spend a lot of time on it, but you can see the citations are there. Those were real sites inside the file. The math is looking pretty good, and it does the equation numbering outside. More math, and our breadcrumbs are going across the top, which is the default. And let's see, conclusions and discussions. So there are our bib items. These were actually put into the file as bib items, so we didn't have to make a bibtex run, but we could have to just go directly from the tech file, nothing else, create bibtex in the interim, BBL file, I should say.
And it looks like the titles are missing.
Let's see what it looks like
in physics literature and chemistry as well.
Yes.
Yeah, these are the actual bib items.
You don't recognize those papers?
No,
this is all ignorance.
This is what it looks like inside the file. So it loaded article, AMS math, and graphics. It did some stuff that we don't need to worry about. And then we just generated the whole thing. How are we doing on time?
You have about 10 minutes.
Oh, light. Nice. I can tell that you guys are mesmerized by this. This is another one that came out to, well, I'm not going to plasTeX it yet. I want to look at it. Because I had to do some tricks, because I didn't know RevTeX 4, But I knew, I could see that, oh, I'm failing on preprint, I'm failing on PACS, email tag, affiliation, and acknowledgements. So I just wanted to get this thing done, so I just said, made a new if plasTeX, and set it to be false. So if I use this with LaTeX or PDF LaTeX, it's not going to pay any attention to all this stuff. It's just going to use RevTeX 4 like it did in the original. I added this block, so if plasTeX is actually using this, it doesn't matter about the new if. plasTeX is going to ignore it. plasTeX is always true when plasTeX is running. And so in that case, I decided, well, I don't know what to do. I think I'll just make preprint do nothing. I'll make a PACS, put things in text, small caps, make email be italic, affiliation, bold, centered, italic. And then this new environment acknowledgement, I just want it to do a line break and put the word acknowledgements in small caps and then put the bolded text inside a quote environment. So I just did that in the preamble, so when plasTeX sees it, it'll be able to expand this and know what to do. So I didn't have to write a template to do this. If it's simple, you can just get away with LaTeX code. If it's more complicated, like you're changing counters on a section or something like that, then you need to get back into the Python code. So a lot of things you can get away with this, but let's see if that's true. There's some EPS files, which I imagine might not look so good when we do this. But it'll convert them. I just don't think they'll look very good. Okay, so it's loading book and graphics. Okay, so we know that it's reading the right part. Otherwise, believe me, it would be choking if it was trying to load RevTeX because it doesn't know what it is. Okay, creating more math. Make sure I'm covering everything. Internal dump. Yep. Okay. Okay, and here this file is, and we've got our email address in italic, affiliation, okay, and our abstract and so forth. We'll just go through this rather quickly. We've got the sites are still working.
I think my title was a little bit botched.
Yeah. You go back to the first page for a sec? Not that it matters.
This one?
Yeah, didn't we lose like a couple authors or something?
Oh yeah, we did. Okay. You guys are good. There is no system right now to put in every author. It just picks. It just has room for one. It's a mistake.
Also, the date is today. Does that mean that this particular article just had an empty date field, or is there a mistake in the translation?
That's a good question. I never had noticed that before.
I don't think the RevTeX sets date. It doesn't use it.
Let's just take a quick look at the...
Yeah, so he's just getting the default book header, which probably has today in there.
Yeah, I bet you're right.
No, date says, today.
Date today, yeah. Good catch.
Unfortunate.
Yeah, they never thought about how that could mess you up. Yep.
What is the picture?
Oh, the pictures, yeah. I knew you were going to ask that. They're not very pretty. Yeah. They need to be converted to something better, you know, so.
Yeah. Couldn't they convert them?
Well, I would assume that's what happened, is that plasTeX converted using the Python image library from EPS to.
Yeah, but is it possible to set up a resolution? It seems that if you just say, do it with high resolution, it will be better. Is it possible to configure different resolution?
Not off the command line. I'm not sure about that.
The EPS file is converted by plasTeX or D by PNG. Which one?
No, it would be plasTeX. Yeah.
plasTeX.
Yeah, because if it's not in a math environment, if it isn't specified that, hey, go use LaTeX, then...
And why the resolution is quite low?
Python's probably thinking it needs to render for a web kind of resolution.
Yeah, I don't know that...
DPI or whatever.
The original may have been altified that.
Yeah, I never even looked at that. So, yeah, I'm not sure about that, but I think if it was a real project of mine, I would have a ping image to bring in instead. The only reason I'm lingering on this page is because of the acknowledgements environment that I set up with LaTeX code Python's understood what to do, or plastic, I should say. It put the acknowledgments in small caps, and then we've got a quote environment, and the text inside is bold. So even though we changed what it did, plastic understood it just from the LaTeX code. Okay, and one thing that I wanted to do is to start my talk off with a command, but it slowed my machine down so much I knew that wasn't going to work. But I'll tell you why I was trying to hard.
Excuse me, I noticed that when you use the mess in title or the header, the size was
not so
small.
Good. Yeah.
So plasTeX can control this one?
I think you could, but you might have to make some changes to your tech file. I'm not sure, because I don't even know what font they're using. But you could use, right now it's using computer modern, I think. But you could load any kind of font that you wanted to. We're using MathTime Pro that'll come out as, you know, they're images, but that's what's used to create the image.
I think that if you put some math in footnotes, you will see it too large.
Yeah.
I have an impression that it just doesn't pick up the text size outside and just renders mapping.
Yeah.
The difficulty here for rendering is that the meaning of various levels of section headings is dependent on the client, not on the producer of the document. So you really have no control over that.
Right, because we've lost context.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's why you can't do anything with your map.
You can make a default mapping of main headings to large with a capital L.
But what might be worth looking at, however, is that simple math that has Roman letters that's a limited set of Greek letters available in HTML subscripts and superscripts, you translate that to HTML.
That would be good.
And that wouldn't be too hard, I think, because you simply have
to parse
a simple string.
When we were running,
you don't recognize, you give it a text.
Exactly. And that's the way Kevin had things running at one time. But at SAS, we had complaints from the writers that they did not like to see it mixed, because they'd have one equation that happened to work out in simple math and the next one didn't, but they were supposed to be showing the similarities between these two with one difference. And it did look kind of odd that way. So. I downloaded the Python library reference. Okay. At one time, Python's documentation was all written in LaTeX. So I just downloaded the whole thing, and I just said plasTeX lib. And then 45 minutes later, which you see why I didn't do that for my talk, we got the Python library reference. It made it all the way through. It didn't choke anywhere. Now, some things could look better, but let's go through here. Take a look at there. We've got nested TOCs. Take a look at that. Well, you know, it looks okay. It could look better, but that was just using plasTeX and lib.tech, which fired up. All these tech files are just included into lib.tech. So for me, that was pretty impressive. 45 minutes, it didn't choke on anything. And I know it's standard LaTeX. I mean, there isn't a lot of fancy stuff in there. But it did make it through, and we actually have a working library reference now. Okay. I think that's it. Thank you.
I have a question.
Yeah. I guess not, since I don't know what that is.
Well, that can do Microsoft document format, but supposedly uses an open XML.
Oh, right, yeah, I know what you're talking about, yeah.
If I need to write a paper and they will only accept it in Word, then...
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. Actually, I get requests to have things put into RTF and Word at SAS, and I think the thing to do is go to DocBook. And then you can output RTF, and I would imagine you could put OpenOffice XML.
Yeah, but what with math? Your math will still be pictures.
Well, what are we supposed to do? I mean, what can you do?
Well, yeah, so the question, it's probably the same one.
Yeah.
Chris is going to ask you, so have you been looking at MathML conversion?
subtle or not.
Well,
which MathML converters have you been looking at?
No, well, I haven't spent much time looking at MathML converters because I took a look at MathML renderers, and until we have something that does a great job, not just an okay job, SAS doesn't want to mess with it because we've got customers to please, and right now I think I don't know what the problem is with the math as images. To me, it looks pretty good, unless you rescale it a lot, in which case obviously it looks bad. But our customers, I don't think, have that expectation.
That's the only problem.
Chris.
So we're coming back to
thank you.
Russ's point in a different way. You're using this system to produce your documentation or just for papers?
No, it's all the documentation.
So your online documentation.
Online, that's right.
It presumably has a lot of cross references.
Lots of cross references. Bibliographies.
Things to code and things like that.
Listings, outputs,
yes,
math.
So you actually need the MathML because you want to link the math to that stuff as well. Someday,
don't you? Oh, I want to change to MathML once it's a standard, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, yeah, definitely. I'm not against MathML.
The next question is, do you know if the plasTeX people are working on?
They're not working on a renderer. They would like to...
No, a converter.
Yeah, I'm sorry, that's what I meant too. They're not working on that. That's why it's meant as a plug-in, so
yeah.
We can take expertise from people that are more expert.
Yeah, so, I mean...
Well, you look at TTH
and... You and us and all these other people who want to use plasTeX need to get together with them and say, look, somehow we must get a group together to do that.
Well, I hear you, but we're customer-driven, and we aren't driven by that yet. I think we will be, but I don't think we're there yet. Our render just looks hard.
Yeah, a lot of these things with customers, if they don't know it's possible, they don't know to ask for it.
Well, but if you've seen the math with
a... If they don't know that you can click on an equation and get it sent off to... your SAS program or Mathematica or whatever.
Well, that's neat, but I think we're concerned about how it looks as well, and so far, I personally haven't seen anything that looks good.
Let me take an example of not exactly a rival to yours, but a very similar organization now, where they have got all their documentation with these sort of links from the math, because they struggle with MathML. And okay, yeah, the rendering is a problem, but Jonathan's going to fix that for us.
That'll be great. Other questions? Comments?
Nice having work volunteer.
So I want to comment that the DML conference about 2 weeks ago, Grant Van, had a presentation of an article in the research that was funded by Design Science on a group of German students that went through every single translator from tech to MathML in a very detailed way. It's a great paper to read.
Yeah.
So if anybody interested in this particular subject, they went through installation and problems and documentation, and then they took an enormous random sample of papers from the archive and translated with each one of them and reported the results.
And are there any good results?
Huh?
Are there any good results?
Oh, I mean, Tech for HT comes up on top very, very big.
Mm-hmm.
But there are some other things that in certain contexts deserves to be noted. And the paper is just absolutely great. I mean, it's an undergraduate paper, but a very nice undergraduate paper.
I'm looking forward to reading that. Yeah.
Thank you, Terry.
Thank you.